Hello and welcome to Irish Pregnancy and Birth with me, Carolyn Coughlin. I am a self-employed community midwife working in the Dublin Midleinster area. The mission of this podcast is to empower pregnant women with the most up-to-date information on all things pregnancy and birth by interviewing maternity healthcare professionals on a different topic every episode. For our fourth episode, we have the man the Lancet called one of the last real general surgeons, the world-renowned obstetrician, Dr. Michel Audon. While in charge of the surgical and maternity units of a hospital just outside Paris from 1962 to 1985, our guest developed a special interest in environmental factors influencing the birthing process. He introduced concepts like home-from-home birthing rooms, birthing pools, and singing sessions for pregnant women. After his hospital career, he was involved in home birth. He founded the Primal Health Research Centre and designed a database, primalhealthresearch.com, in order to compile his epidemiological studies exploring correlations between what happens during the primal period and health later on. Today we'll be talking about the science of birth and our relationship with nature. Michel Audon, you're very welcome to the show.
Good morning.
There is a kind of a false assumption in Ireland with people who believe in science favour interventions and hospital birth, while those who believe in the power of intuition generally lean towards natural birth and home birth. What has struck me about your writings is that you show that natural birth and home birth are scientifically much better options for the majority of women, and that the less scientific emotional response that leads people to favour hospital births. Can you tell us more about some of the ways how the scientific evidence supports natural birth and home birth?
Yes. In fact, we don't really need scientific evidence. We can start with what is obvious. It's important today, when we are constantly in unprecedented situation, we analyze the situation, and after that, we phrase, create question. So let's start from what is obvious, what is sure, what you cannot discuss. That from a biological point of view, say when you consider the environment at birth in terms of microbes and so on, it's impossible to replace home birth. When we start from this perspective, we can say, for sure, it's not an opinion. It's not talking about what is good or what is bad. That's the point. We can say that there have been a revolution in less than a century in regarding the way human babies are born. It's from this perspective, biological perspective. A century ago, women were almost always giving birth among a great diversity of familiar microbes. It's obvious. It was like that. Today, it's the opposite. Everybody knows that. We don't need to give details. You said that when you are in a delivery room in your hospital or in an operating room, the bacteriological environment is not the same at home. So important as a way to start to realize that in less than a century, there has been a big revolution in the birth environment. And this revolution was from a bacteriological perspective. The point is to understand why it's important. And after that, what we have to do is to phrase appropriate question. I think when we are together, we don't need to give opinion, to tell people what to do. In some minutes together, what we have to do is to phrase appropriate questions. We are in an unprecedented situation. So now, what next? I must say that in general, I'll show you one thing. Then, whatever the topic, we can always say we are in absolutely new situation, unprecedented situation. What to do, what to do? Avoid opinions, avoid theories. Don't talk about what is good, what is bad. Phrase appropriate question. Constantly, we can talk about effect of human activities on climate. You can talk about pollution of the ocean. It's new situation. Let's phrase appropriate question. And this is exactly at a way to introduce our conversation. The topic of my latest book in English. I'll show you just the cover, just the cover. Look at the cover. What do you see? Question mark, a big question mark in red. You know? This is what we have to do today. With always phrasing question marks. So let's start from this new situation.
Yes.
A century ago, men were giving birth among a great diversity of familiar microbes. Today, it's the opposite. So the question is, why is it important? And why is it important in the case of human beings, of being giving birth in a familiar or non-familiar environment? When we talk about human beings, what is essential, what we need to know now, it was not important in the past, but now it's important, that when a human baby is born, the microbes that are familiar for the mother are already familiar and therefore friend for the newborn baby. That because there is something special among human beings. The human placenta has a special structure. The human placenta is very effective at transferring the maternal antibodies, those we call IgG, from the maternal bloodstream to the fetal bloodstream. So a human baby is born, this human baby, it's not true for the little calf or the mouse, that's for the human baby, has the same antibodies as the mother. It means that microbes that are familiar and friendly for the mothers are also familiar and friendly for the newborn babies before the baby is colonized by other microbes. That we have to understand. So among other mammals, take a little calf. The question is, how the baby's body, the calf, the body of the calf will be immediately will receive the appropriate antibodies from the mother. Among little calf is the colostrum. But among human beings, even if the colostrum, the early colostrum, what baby can find in the breast, in the afterbirth, even it's precious, it's not vital, and being can survive without the colostrum. So the question is different. Among human beings, the big question is, which microbes will be the first to colonize the baby's body and to start programming, educating the immune system? This is the big question among human beings. So what is at stake when we talk about that is how human health starts to be organized in the period of birth. And it depends a lot about the bacteriological environment. A big difference between familiar environment and non-familiar environment, and also diversity of the microbes, the number of microbes and so on. So this is a big question. Suddenly, we realize that today, from a bacteriological perspective, you say when we consider our health is organized, there are two kinds of birth. Birth at home and birth elsewhere. impossible to replace.
Yes.
The home environment from a political perspective. That's what people understand. And what is at stake is how our health is organized, how the human system is organized. So what we're expecting now, because we raise questions, it's a new generation of studies trying to evaluate to which extent the increased prevalence of some diseases like allergic diseases, like autoimmune diseases, asthma, also viral diseases, to which extent this increased prevalence of human diseases is related to birth environment, and particularly to the bacteriological environment. So this is a question we have to refresh today. Until now, people have not thought of that, not at all. There have been some studies by allergists about comparing the risk of allergic diseases, for example, or autoimmune diseases, in relation to the way babies are born. But they always contrasted hospital birth with hospital birth.
Yes.
Babies born by vaginal route, babies born that way, this way, antibiotics and so on. But they, what we need is not, it's something different. What we need, and it has never been done, is the effect of bacteriological environment at home and bacterial environment elsewhere. So if in the future people consider this issue serious, if, as it's very possible, they can demonstrate that the increased prevalence of many dysregulation of the immune system, diseases, are related to the bacteriological environment at birth, suddenly we'll be obliged to demarginalize home birth. That the, when we talk today about the issue of home birth versus hospital birth, the dominant perspective should be bacteriological and immunological. Our health is developed, is organized, is programmed. So here we are today, very important question at the age of viral disease, of coronavirus and so on. People don't raise that question. Viral diseases of the immune system. The first question is about how the immune system developed. How started programming the system? That should be the first question. So if we start from this question, we're obliged to consider as essential the question we are raising today together. What are the differences between home birth and hospital birth? Many reasons in the future, if you accept the phrase appropriate question, many reasons, you know, to perhaps one day to demarginalize home birth. You look at that a different way. Now, it cannot be overnight. Many conditions are necessary for that, accepting the new ways of thinking. But here we are today, the age, we are in the age of question marks.
Yes. And you discussed before as well about how the structure of the human placenta is very different to the structure of the placentas in other mammals, that we fetuses receive a lot more IgG, you know, from the placenta in utero than other mammals.
Yes. What's important to, I don't want to give me technical details.
Yes, that I found
but
that
the human placenta is called hemochorial. What does it mean? It means that between the maternal bloodstream and the fetal bloodstream, there is only one thin membranes, and in these membranes there are active cells that transfer the maternal antibodies called IgG towards the fetal bloodstream. Well, among most other mammals, is different. Among most of the mammals, there are several membranes, and in reality, babies have not received maternal antibodies before being born. So the questions are different. That's why when we talk about childbirth from a biological perspective and immunological perspective, we must immediately clarify our question, saying we are talking about human beings.
Yes.
The questions are not the same, are different according to different species of mammals. So we have to go about human beings.
Yes, that's very interesting.
It's interesting that you asked me to talk a little bit more about the placenta, because until now, we must say there was a lack of interest in general in medical studies, midwifery studies, about the structure of the human placenta. It was not considered, it was not important. I'm sure when you were studying midwifery, you have not studied in detail the structure of the hemochorion human placenta, you know, why the antibodies go easily to the fetal bloodstream. I'm sure you have not studied that in detail. It's absolutely essential today. Today is essential because such a difference between home birth and birth elsewhere. Now we must change the way we classify the birth in the people, medical field, or people in groups promoting natural childbirth, what they call natural childbirth. Until now, they always contrast vaginal birth and cesarean section. That's not the important point. The important point is home birth and birth elsewhere.
Yes.
We must phrase the question in different ways. Don't give opinion, don't anticipate, but realize why it's so important. That's all. What people understand and why it's so important today, particularly at a time when we are facing a serious disease of our immune system, difficult to cope with viruses and so on. So that should be the first question before anything else. Of course, at the present time, we have to think short term, how to get rid of this coronavirus. We have to think short term. But it's not a reason not to raise long-term question, development of the human being. So everything is so new. So that's why it's so important that we talk together about that.
Yes. Okay, so another false assumption is that science and nature are somehow in opposition, that those who are keen on natural approaches are resistant to scientific approaches, but you seem to have a relationship with science and nature as perfectly harmonious. You've stated that our relationship with nature is a relationship and that it is cultural conditioning that is often anti-scientific. The way that human beings birthed before the advent of civilization and agriculture with undisturbed births, skin-to-skin contact between mother and baby, the giving of colostrum may have been instinctive, and yet science seems to be proving the importance of these factors to the health of both mother and baby. How do you think we can better communicate the scientific foundations of what at first glance seems to be returned to primitive methods?
There is not really a contradiction between science and nature. The contradiction is between tradition and science. And in fact, today, many emerging and fast-developing scientific disciplines are obliging us to get rid of tradition. The point today is to get rid of tradition. The contrast is between science and tradition. So it's a good way to realize why we are in a very special situation. We must recall something we have not always understood. As you know, about 10,000 years ago, our ancestors started to dominate nature, domesticating plants, agriculture, domesticating animals, husbandry, But what we have not before, what we have not realized, that there was also to a certain extent a domestication of human beings at the same time. And in particular, the control, the organization, the regulation of some human physiological functions. And so this was the case for childbirth. Before this revolution, 10,000 years ago, which is usually called the Neolithic Revolution. Recently, 10,000 years ago, it's recent in the history of mankind. So that was the beginning of domination of nature. Before that time, we know that women used to isolate themselves to give birth. We have enough data to say they were separating from the group, isolating themselves. And suddenly, birth was socialized. But the point is that the socialization of birth has many facets, many aspects. Of course, the presence of somebody, which was new, but also the transmission from generation to generation of beliefs and rituals have interfered dramatically with the physiological processes. So, with variants, but the main points were roughly the same everywhere. Controlling, interfering. For example, among beliefs that have been transmitted from generation to generation on the five continents, was the belief that the colostrum, what baby can find in the breast immediately after birth, is bad for the baby. Almost everywhere from that time, the initiation of breastfeeding was delayed 2 or 3 days. It has been like that. Tradition was a tradition. Until now, until the time, end of the 20th century, when we learned that baby can find the breast during the hour following birth, and colostrum is precious. So at the present time, we need science to reconstitute the traditional. So contrast science and nature, we have to contrast tradition and modern science. Because during many centuries, millennia, childbirth was more and more socialized, more and more in cultural interferences, religion, and so on. And recently, during the second half of the 20th century, new aspects of the social of childbirth, the environment was masculinized, baby's father was introduced, it was absolutely new, and more and more medicalized. So we have reached extreme limit of the socialization of childbirth at such a point that today, at a global level, the number of women can still give birth to the baby and to the placenta, thanks to delays of their natural hormones, which are hormones of love. This number is becoming insignificant. Yes. We have reached the limits of the domination of nature when we consider childbirth. That's a way to phrase now the good question. How to take another direction? No, if we have reached the limit, if we are at the edge of the precipice, no need for hormone of for babies and so on. The question is how to take another direction. And to take another direction, we have to reconsider completely the way we understand the birth process. We have to reconsider completely the way we understand the basic need of a laboring woman after thousands of years of social of childbirth. It will not be easy, but there are two reasons to be a little bit optimistic, to think that it's possible. Two conditions. The first condition is that we accept to take as a point of departure a new question. You studied midwifery, you learn in your textbook a little bit about birth physiology, not a lot, but what you read about birth physiology has always had the same point of departure. The point of departure was why human births are difficult. And immediately, you are offered an answer. Human births are difficult for mechanical, morphological reasons. And you had pictures of the size and the shape of the skeleton of the pelvis of the mother, the shape, the size of baby's head, and you were said, for mechanical reasons, human births are difficult. Full stop. You don't need to say more. You cannot change the shape of the mother's body overnight. You don't need to know. It's difficult for mechanical reasons. Full stop. It's all a matter. Once more, once more, once more. That's the point.
Yes.
Another matter is to start from another question.
Yes.
A question you understand. You are a special midwife, you understand. The main question should be, why occasionally human births are easy and fast?
Yes.
Why some women who apparently are not special, but they give birth to their baby very quickly, no need for the midwife, just the time to arrive, not always, you know. That's a question. Why human births occasionally are easy and fast? If we start from this question, we have to reconsider everything. Mm-hmm. And if we start from this question, why human birth be easy? At that time, you can find another reason to go a step further. If you take into consideration what we are learning at the present time from neurophysiology. Today, we are learning a lot from physiologists,
yes,
interested in particular in brain functions. As long as the question was why human births are difficult, people were looking at the skeleton, at the pelvis of the skeleton. Today, when you start from the other question, in the age of modern neurophysiology, you understand that birth physiology is first a chapter of brain physiology. Mm. What's important is what happens in the brain,
yes,
in the, not in the... So what is today, what's important to consider, to analyze,
yes,
to talk about, is what we are learning about human brain. You know that human brain is spatial, more developed than among any other mammals. And in particular, one part of the brain, we call the new brain, in other words, in technical word, the neocortex.
Yes.
The neocortex is highly, highly developed among humans. The point is that until recently, the neocortex, or neocortex, was presented as a tool at the service of vital physiological function. It was a tool providing information about space, time, about facilitating communication. It, because we have such a big neocortex, highly developed neocortex, that we can, we are so special that we can do mathematics. We can communicate between London and Dublin with a computer because human beings, highly developed human neocortex, could develop all these techniques for sending human beings to the moon. We are so special because of our big neocortex. Absolutely unique. But the point that today we realize that the new brain, the neocortex, the powerful neocortex, is not always a tool at the service of physical function. In some situations, it's the opposite. In some situations, the activity of the new brain, of the neocortex, can inhibit, can make more difficult human physiological functions. we have not the time to give a list of all the physical functions.
Yes.
That can be inhibited by the neocortex. For a good example is the sense of smell. A good example. It has been demonstrated scientifically that if you drink a glass of wine, alcohol, after that, your sense of smell is more powerful. That does it mean. Usually, the sense of smell is inhibited, is made more difficult, it doesn't work well, is inhibited by activity of the neocortex. That's an example. You learn at school about primitive, archaic, primitive reflexes that you can demonstrate on a newborn baby, and after that, they disappear, and the neocortex is a little more powerful. So today, to understand human nature, we must give a great importance to what we are learning about the neocortex. And to understand that a neocortical activity can inhibit some physical function. And this is the case of childbirth. That's what we must understand today, that giving birth is not the business of the thinking brain, of the logical brain, of the neocortex. Giving birth is the business of archaic, primitive part of the brain. And what's important to realize today is the solution that nature found to make human birth possible and even potentially easy. Nature found a solution, easy to explain, and for you, easy perhaps to understand. When a woman is giving birth, her neocortex, her new brain, her logical brain, must stop working. Okay. It's not a business to give birth.
Okay.
And I'm sure that as a home birth midwife, you are special, and I'm sure you can understand what people have forgotten for centuries now, because of tradition, but you can still understand that when a woman can give birth easily, quickly, she does not need, even that you arrive at the house, maybe it's born before, but or immediately born. You know that in this case, when a woman is in such a labor, in this case, she's as if cutting herself from her world, indifferent to what happens around.
Yeah.
She can be in a strange way, shouting, screaming, swearing, and so on and so on. Strange signs. For example, people have not often noticed it, but so important. Woman in hard labor, working well, very fast, she can smell, recall odors that other people cannot perceive. She can perceive odors, complain about odors, people didn't pay attention. Her sense of smell is very powerful, a very good sign of reduced neocortical activity. And when a woman is like that all over the planet, she can find by herself bizarre postures, positions,
yes,
often primitive, mammalian, unexpected postures, so bizarre, unexpected postures. It's obvious in this case, and I'm sure you know what I'm talking about. Yes. Not many people can understand that. You know that in this case, obviously, there is a reduced neocortical control. This is a solution that nature found to make human birth possible. And this is what we have rediscovered with the help of sciences. It's not a contradiction with science. On the contrary, we need the emerging, fast-developing scientific discipline to contrast with tradition. We have to forget tradition. We have to forget ritual belief and so on, domination of nature. We have to forget. So today, that the when we have understood this point, that to give birth a woman need to reduce control by the neocortex, the rest is simple. you don't have long time to realize that what a woman needs when she's in labor is not to be protected against all possible stimulation of her neocortex. So in this case, the key word is protection. That's new. She needs to be protected. You cannot help her. You cannot help a woman to give birth. You cannot help an involuntary protest process. But you can protect the laboring woman against all possible stimulation of her neocortex. When we said that, the rest is so simple, because everybody knows what can stimulate the neocortex of a human being. Everybody knows about language. The worst thing to do when a woman is in labor is to talk to her. It's simple, but we need sophisticated scientific discipline to understand that we should not talk to a woman in labor. Also, we know that light stimulates the neocortex. We know more about light today, melatonin, but it's a detail. And in general, because we don't need to give details, it's so simple. For avoid language, avoid light, avoid all situations that can stimulate the attention of a woman in labor. So I don't need to give details. For example, if you observe a woman in labor, she will observe herself. It's a stimulation of her neocortex. So a woman in labor should not feel observed. If she worried about something happening around, worried about a possible dangerous situation, she will pay attention. So avoid a woman in labor to pay attention to something. So that is it. I don't need to say more like that. The point is to understand that women need to be protected against what can disturb her. And that's a new way of thinking, absolutely new way of thinking. Until now, after thousands of years of socialized birth, we're thinking as if a woman cannot give birth without some cultural interferences. We always talk, who delivered the baby? We doctor, we midwife, we never talk about giving birth. It's a way, dominant way of thinking we have to reconsider today. So it means we have to reconsider for vocabulary. When we have to change our way of thinking, how to start? It's not easy to reconsider thousands of years of university. You can try to start with vocabulary. Today, when you consider the keyword commonly used regarding human birth, the focus is always on the active role of somebody else than the two obligatory actors. The two obligatory actors are mother and baby.
Yeah.
But the vocabulary is focusing on somebody else, helping, guiding, controlling a word, a terrible word. Among people talk about natural childbirth. Oh, coaching.
Yes.
Look at that. What does it mean, coaching? Coaching, you are not able to give birth. You need a coach. From my point of view, this is the ultimate phase of a cultural misunderstanding of birth physiology. It's a book which is well known, particularly in America, among people who promote natural childbirth. But it's going to have the 20th century. But what a misunderstanding. To give birth, you need a coach. You need somebody who knows, who will guide you. That means really they have not understood. And let's go a little further. Who can be the coach? Man, who's never given birth, I've never seen a birth. He can. And look at this cover, just the cover. Method of natural birth. When there is a method, it's not natural. You cannot combine the word method and the word natural. Methods are created by human beings, are not. So that's the ultimate phase of the deep-rooted misunderstanding of birth physiology, in particular in group promoting natural numbers. Among doctors, it's the same. They don't talk about coaching, but they talk about labor management. It's the same. Some groups promoting natural childbirth, medical milieus, in the same way of thinking. It's cultural. It's cultural. And only today, only scientific perspective can make it possible to reconsider thousands of years of conditioning. Here we are at the present time. So it's only if we suddenly we accept to understand what we can learn about discipline of laboring women, you can learn from emerging scientific discipline, such as neurophysiology. If you take into account with what we are learning from bacteriology, from immunology, and so on, when we mix all that, it might be possible to demarginalize home birth. We have to mix all that. It's sciences to face tradition. We need sciences to face tradition. It's not opposed to nature and sciences, but on the contrary. We need sciences to, and we have to oppose it to get rid of thousands of years of socialization. So here we are at the present time. Why? That's why today, perhaps still more easier today to talk about that because people start realizing that the way our immune system is an important issue, virus and so on. Today, the priority is to there to phrase all these questions. How our human system is educated, serious. In fact, I give really opinions. When I say it's serious, how our human system is educated, it should be common sense, you know, it's common sense. So I think I must thank you for taking the initiative of this conversation. And I think that we can realize together that we are really entering a new phase in the history of childbirth on the condition that we accept to learn from emerging and fast developing scientific discipline. What we have to realize how serious are these issues, how health is organized. The fact that no need for hormone of love to have give birth to babies and placenta. It's incredibly serious. That's what we have to explain to everybody. Talking about childbirth should not be introducing a topic for midwives, doulas, doctors, pregnant women. It will be a topic for all those interested in the future of human beings. It's incredibly serious. Yes. But we have to train ourselves to phrase appropriate question. We are in the age of question. We have to explain to everybody that whatever the topic, we are at the edge of the precipice. We have reached the limits of the domination of nature. What can we do, having reached the limits, to take another direction? And about childbirth, to take another direction is to take into account what are learning from emerging and fast developing scientific discipline. So, Caroline, thank you for introducing this conversation.
It's
an important issue.
Yeah, it's just absolutely mind-blowing listening to you talk. Wow, it's a completely different way of thinking, as you said. You've written in your new book, Future of Homo, how the way we birth may be affecting our evolution as the species. I guess you've talked a little bit about that, but can you expand a little bit more for our listeners what you mean about this concept of how the way we are birthing is affecting us evolves?
It's sure that there are a lot to say.
Yes.
Different reasons why. The way babies are born today might interfere with the evolution of our species. It's a difficult issue, and there is a reason why it's a difficult issue. It is, you know, there are futurologists, people who explore the future. You heard about that.
Yes.
But in general, they are only interested in the effect of human activities, you know, effect on the weather, effect on the pollution, effect on that human activities.
Yes, yes.
And they are experts in evolution, but they only look at the past. Experts on evolution study the past. What we need are futurologists who would be experts in evolution and would phrase new questions. It's a huge, very important issue. I don't want to say too long. I just summarize what is essential that you need to understand.
Thank
is
you.
That today, reproductive medicine in general, and of course, medicine obstetric, when they are born obstetric, today, reproductive medicine is neutralizing the laws of natural selection. Everybody heard about the laws of natural selection. In the past, for example, until recently, there were still these laws, they were still effective, you know. Women who could give birth easily, in general, they have many babies. And women who could not give birth, for some reasons, they could not have babies. There was a natural selection. It's an example. Today, it's not like that. Today, if you cannot give birth, a woman cannot give birth by herself, but you can do a C-section. It's safe, it's easy. And if you have the number of babies you want to have, for example, if you want to have two babies, after that, you have contraception. So the number of babies per woman today is not influenced by the capacity to give birth. It's influenced mostly by other factors. That means we have neutralized the laws of natural selection. The same with conception of babies. Very fertile people don't have more babies than people who are not fertile with contraception, with in vitro fertilization, medication. So we have neutralized the laws of natural selection. That's serious. I don't want to say that we should stop the law of natural selection. We cannot stop doing cesarean section, but it's a way to wonder, but how long can humanity survive after neutralizing the laws of natural selection? Once more, it's only a question. I don't want to say how much. I'll show you cover of another book, just a minute.
Yes, please do.
This one of my books, but it's a French edition. I think you can read the title. I can translate perhaps for some of you. Can humanity survive medicine? If we are rational, if we consider we have radically neutralized the laws of natural selection that are several billion years old, theoretically, if we are rational, humanity cannot survive, in particular, survive to reproductive medicine. So I don't want to say more.
Yeah.
Once more, I don't want to say more. Many factors. I just want to say that today, what the important point is that. Look.
Yes.
The question mark. Is it not new in the history of life that laws of natural selection have been neutralized? So, huge topic, another huge topic. I don't want to say more now. It's too important, and because the the only thing I can do, we can do, is to phrase appropriate questions.
Yeah, and I guess you talk about how the decrease in vaginal births is having unforeseen effects on babies. So, like, just briefly again, I know you've talked there about how cesarean section is affecting us our evolution, but then maybe the side effects of cesarean section, for example, or the decrease in vaginal births on babies themselves. Can you give some examples what side effects the babies themselves are experiencing?
Some side effects of cesarean section. I think it's a very important question once more. I'll summarize. I think that today, from the point of view of the baby, I'll talk about the point of view of the baby, not the point of view of adults. The point is not to contrast vaginal birth and cesarean section. From the point of view of the baby, the point is to contrast birth with labor and birth without labor. What is very special today, new in the history of mankind, is that babies are born by cesarean section before the labor starts. It means they have not given a signal saying my lungs are mature, they have not been exposed to maternal and fetal stress hormones. They are born like that, before the labor starts. These babies are very different from all the others. So the point today is to contrast birth with labor and birth without labor. When a baby is born by cesarean section after several hours of labor, these babies is much more like those born by the vaginal route, babies. So once more, your question is important, because, and I don't want to say more, because once more, it means what we have to do is to phrase new questions in absolutely new situation. Until recently, the question was it the difference between a human being born by vaginal route compared with a human being born by C-section? Today, from the point of view of the baby, adults can have another point of view, can prefer to plan a cesarean section on Wednesday at 10 o'clock in the morning rather than to do an emergency cesarean section on Sunday, of course. But from the point of view of the baby, there are two kinds of birth with labor and birth without labor. That is to say, birth by cesarean section before the labor starts and all the other births. So that's another good way, another important topic.
Yes.
Another way to say, we have to phrase appropriate questions. We are in the age of question marks.
Wow.
I think not now, because there are still thousands of other questions you might face, and we can probably meet another time for other questions.
Amazing, yeah. So you just said there that we reached a limit in terms of interventions, and that undisturbed birth has pretty much been eradicated outside of small pockets here and there. What do you think is the main impact on the change, and do you think it is reversible? Is this the symbiotic revolution that you spoke about earlier? You spoke about the symbiotic revolution. Is it possible? So I guess, is this what you're trying to say?
Yes, you mentioned the term symbiotic revolution. Yes, it's a big, big topic. Yes. It's a way to, perhaps we can conclude of that until now, and for the last 10,000 of years, since the Neolithic revolution, we have been dominating nature. Agriculture, animal husbandry, how human physical processes are controlled. Thousands of years we have been dominating nature. That was the basic strategy for survival of human beings, dominating nature. Now, suddenly, we need to learn to live with nature. What it's what I call a symbiotic revolution. We are you are a living creature. We have to learn to live with other living creatures. This is the meaning of this phrase. It's a new way of thinking, new strategy for survival. That's the meaning of the symbiotic revolution. I'm pleased to finish our meeting with the term symbiotic revolution, living with nature. I said that in different ways, but this way is easily understood. Yeah. Thank you.
Thank you. I just have one more question. So we're in the midst of a global pandemic, and I guess you focused a lot today about the immunological, or you know, the reasons for natural home birth is the bacteriological effects on us. And obviously, coronavirus is a new virus to humans. But do you think breastfed babies born vaginally at home without intervention are statistically likelier to have a better immune response to novel infections?
It's a question. What we need is to phrase your question again and again and again, so people provide precise answers. Common sense suggests that yes, of course, in terms of organization, maturation, development of the immune system, probably, ideally, it's better to be born. easily as possible, and then to be breastfed. It's common sense. Of course, still some people would like more precise demonstration, you know, long-term effect. We need studies. There is no risk of study. No. Perhaps it's another possible conclusion, but today, the number of question of studies we should have in our mind is incredible. Everything is new, you know. All what we do is new. How to? Often we are like apprentice sorcerers. I don't know if you understand that. All what we do is new, and we don't know. We have no answers to this question. For example, all babies are exposed several times to ultrasound during fetal life. Apparently, there is no negative side effect, apparently. But what about life expectancy? We don't know. 10 vaccinations in early infancy. What about long-term non-specific effect on health, life expectancy? We don't know. Being exposed to high doses of synthetic oxytocin during the birth process, what are the possible long-term effects? We don't know. So we are at a time when age of questions.
Yes.
But also an age when we have to dare to say, we don't know, we don't know, we don't know, we don't know. So perhaps that's a good condition to accept that we don't know. Yes. Thank you.
Yeah, fantastic. Thank you so much for your time, Michelle. I'm so pleased with you for taking the time out to come to the show, and your writings have been very inspiring for me. I look forward to reading your book. I haven't read your book yet, The Future of Homo, and I hope that everyone listening will join in ordering the book. It sounds fascinating and thought-provoking. Thank you so much for your time today and for all your work you've done to promote the science of natural birth. I've been your host and midwife, Carolyn Coughlin. I hope you've enjoyed the show. We'll be back soon with an interview with Dr. Jack Newman, so don't forget to subscribe now. For more, keep an eye on my website, dublinhomebirth.com, or my social media at dublinhomebirth.